Today I'd like to draw our attention to the glory of the gospel of grace. What it means. You know, oftentimes the gospel is, I don't know, somehow it's not connected to the covenant that God promised to Abraham. And you know what God told Abraham is in you all nations of the earth would be blessed. Not just Israel, but all nations of the earth would be blessed. And that's because he is the father of the faithful. Not just the father of the Jewish or Israelite faithful, but the father of all. That's why Paul told the Galatians that you are Abraham's offspring indeed. If you're in Christ Jesus, you are Abraham's offspring. You're his descendants, and not just his descendants. You are heirs of the promises made to him. Now, Abraham was not motivated by a land flowing with milk and honey. We know that by Hebrews chapter 11, where what motivated, what he was searching for was a city whose architect and builder is God. He was looking for a heavenly country. He wasn't looking for a fig tree. He wasn't looking for a vineyard or a nice pasture land to put his sheep and his goats in. I mean, that's all nice. I mean, don't you like to have your own property? And don't you like to enjoy what God has created out here? I mean, I love to go out on this lake out here and take my boat out. I like to walk the trails. We have so many beautiful trails here. My wife and I take our dogs for a walk here. My dog and my grandpup for a walking. And sometimes others. And I enjoy that. But it's not my home.
Amen.
It's not home. And the only way that I can be a citizen of the kingdom of God and to be a part of the heavenly country that I long for is to be born again of a holy seed, which is Jesus, a promised seed we see in Galatians chapter 3, in order that I can be a new creation and that I can enter into a new covenant, the covenant that was promised to Abraham and was ratified by the Lamb of God in the form of Jesus Christ. You see, the gospel of grace is the covenant of grace through faith. We are saved by grace through faith. Now, we have to understand that God gave the children of Israel a different covenant. That's why the end of chapter 8 of Hebrews tells that that covenant is becoming obsolete, you see. But that was a covenant, and he gave them his laws and his statutes. But he added laws because of transgressions. That's what we see in Galatians chapter 3, you remember? He said, listen, a covenant that came 430 years after the promise to Abraham that had laws added because of transgressions does not nullify a promise of a covenant, you know, previously a promise to Abraham. So that covenant was realized when Jesus came. Now, a lot of people think because this, you know, the Sinai covenant was a covenant where righteousness came from your ability to keep God's law, which simply means instruction. But we can see it summed up in the Ten Commandments, certainly. And Moses said that. He said, he told the children of Israel in the book of Deuteronomy, he said, and you keeping this law will be righteousness to you. But at the end of his life, when he was about to die, he said, write the book of the law and put it on the outside of the covenant, the Ark of the Covenant. And it shall stand as a witness against you. Why? Because they never kept the covenant. Now, could they have kept the covenant? Let me ask you this. If someone could keep God's law perfectly, would you need a redeemer? No, you wouldn't need a redeemer because the Bible says all have fallen short. Everyone, every single person from the beginning of time other than Jesus has fallen short. Even if you're trying, as try as you might. Abraham was the father of the faithful, but did Abraham sin? Yes. Did Abraham die? Yes. But was righteousness imputed to Abraham because through faith? Yes. Right. So Abraham is going to be risen in the first resurrection at the return of Christ Jesus, along with the other saints who have gone before us. Amen?
Amen.
And so it's a covenant of grace through faith, ratified by a righteous Savior, the Lamb of God, who we call Jesus Christ. So let us understand that. When Jesus said, he said in John chapter 3, he summed up the gospel, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in him," and that means to receive him, to receive who he is the Word, he's the life. "Whoever would believe him should not perish but have everlasting life. There is no other name under heaven by which anyone can be saved other than the name of Jesus." Now, having said that, what do we find in Hebrews chapter 8 when it says, before it says, the old covenant has become obsolete, and that Jesus has ratified a new covenant? He said, in this covenant, in the new covenant, "I will write my laws in your minds and on your hearts." So again, it's not a covenant without obedience to God's laws. Although, as we see in Galatians 3, it does not include all of the laws that were added because of transgressions 430 years later. Now, that's obvious to see if we just think about it. Because in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus said, "Never imagine I've come to destroy the law or the prophets. I've not come to destroy, but to fulfill. And until heaven and earth," you hear that? Mm-hmm. "Until heaven and earth pass away, not one comma shall pass from the law." Heaven and earth has not passed away.
Amen.
Therefore, he says it has not passed, it's still in force. But understand this. When you read on in chapter 5 of Matthew, you see that Jesus makes a clear distinction between laws that were added, the laws that came later at Sinai that were added because of transgressions. In other words, the laws that are a part of the Sinai covenant, which is not our covenant. Our covenant is the one promised to Abraham. But that he makes a clear distinction. In other words, he magnifies two of the Ten Commandments. He said, "You have heard that it says, you shall not commit adultery. But I say, if you lust, if you look after a woman in your heart, or you look with lust in your heart, you've committed adultery already." It says the same thing about hatred being murder. See, he magnified. He made the letter of the law bigger in the Ten Commandments. Then later on, he says, "Now, you have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for tooth. But I say, no." Well, nine, tooth for tooth is in the book of Exodus. That is a commandment of the law of Moses that was written on a tablet, on a scroll, and placed beside the Ark of the Covenant. It is a part of Torah. It is a part of the law of Sinai. But Jesus clearly says that's not in our covenant. But he's clearly saying the Ten Commandments are. Because not only do you not commit adultery, you don't even think about it. Not only do you not commit murder, but you don't have hate. You don't have hatred in your heart. You see, it goes beyond the letter. You see, but then he says, "You have heard that that you're to honor your vows." But I say, don't make a vow. Now, listen. If you look in the Old Testament, that the laws that were given to Moses, they were clearly told to make vows. They were clearly told to do animal sacrifices. We see that those are not a part of our covenant. What I'm saying is this. There are people that are messianics. They'll say, "Well, we got to go back to Torah. We got to keep all these laws." Well, you're contrary to what Jesus said, and you're doing contrary to what Paul wrote, Galatians chapter 5. He says, if you receive circumcision, then you are obligated to go back to the whole law, and you're severed from Christ. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, the very same apostle said that what matters is keeping the commandments of God. Now, Jesus said clearly, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. He who abides in me keeps my commandments. You find in 1 John that this is love, that you keep his commandments and they are not a burden to you. We find in the book of James in chapter 2 that we're going to be judged by the perfect law of liberty. And he identifies that law of liberty as the Ten Commandments. He names some of the commandments. In Matthew chapter 19, to the young rich ruler, when he asked Jesus, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He said, to keep the commandments of God. And he said, which ones? Why? Because there's 630 of them, or 600 and whatever many. Over 600 of them. And so he said, he named some of the Ten Commandments, and that's all he named. Now, some people say, well, he didn't name the Sabbath. He didn't name the first commandment either, to love your God with your own heart, you know, with all your heart. So you can't use those things. Listen, brethren, don't look for loopholes. Because you know what happens with a loophole? You get hung by it. You have to seek the truth, nothing but the truth, and love the truth. 2 Thessalonians says that in the end time, those who perish will perish because they do not receive a love of the truth. John chapter 4, to the woman at the well, Jesus said, the Father is seeking true worshipers. You hear me? I said true worshipers. What do true worshipers do? He went on to say, true worshipers who will worship him in spirit and in truth. For he must be worshipped in spirit and truth. If you don't have the truth, you don't have anything. There's a lot of people that make their own gods in their own imagination. My God wouldn't do this. My God wouldn't do this. My God allows this. And my God, he thinks it's perfectly okay to do this. But that's an imaginary God. You see, that's not the same God that will judge you on Judgment Day. That's not the same God that looks down from heaven that gave his only son for you. Listen, we're not saved by works. We're not saved by the works of the law. But we are saved to be obedient to God. We'll never make it. We will always fall short. Like Paul said in Romans chapter 7, with my mind I agree with the law of God, but I find the members of my body doing the exact opposite. Oh, wretched man that I am. See, that's what Paul thought of himself. What do you think about yourself? C.S. Lewis once said, all you have to do is to find out how bad you are is to try to be good. You've heard me talk about, I used to keep a planner. It was my work planner when I ran, you know, their advertising business that Michael has now. But I had at the bottom on the corner down here, spiritual things, character things, you know, like humility and forgiveness and, you know, certain things down there, morality and whatever, self-control and all the things, you know. I was taping those little fruits of the Spirit on. I'm going to get this one right there and tape it right there. Well, it didn't, you know. That's just looking like. It looks like I've got the fruits of the Holy Spirit, you see. But this little tree didn't produce them. I just got them somewhere else, like a little artificial. It looks like an orange of self-control, you know, or over here, this is peace. But I forgot what I was going to say now. You guys shouldn't distract me like that. What?
You're talking about your planner.
My planner, because in there I scored myself, you know, and every day, at the end of the day, I'd score myself, you know. And I had a score for humility. And so when I got really high, you know, high score on humility, I was proud of myself. I'm telling you, it's a miracle what God, I'm still here, and he hadn't struck me, and I mean, he's been so patient, you know. I mean, that's how stupid I really was, and I guess maybe 10 years from now, I'll look and see how stupid I really am now. I don't know. You guys act like you already know, but don't. But you know, that balance, because here's the thing. We don't, you know, we believe in keeping the commandments of God. That's why we're here on the Sabbath. We believe in keeping the commandments of God. But we have to always remember that even though we try, we're never going to do it. We're not going to do it. But God's commandments show us a standard. I mean, you know, when he says to us, everyone has fallen short of the glory of God. Do you know 2 Corinthians chapter 3 says that the commandments came with glory? You know, we fall short of that glory. Yes, we want to obey God. We want to love the Lord our God with all of our heart and all of our soul and all of our mind. But do we? We don't. That's the truth of the matter. So we don't, even though we believe in keeping God's commandments, we never should be foolish to think that we don't fall short. We do fall short. And when we understand that because God always knew we would fall short, even though we strive for the mark, even though we strive to obey God, we want to please him, we're striving to, we know that in our own selves we will always fall short. Therefore, God gave his own son. Therefore, we have a high priest who was tempted in all things as we are, And he stands there at the throne of God for us, to make intercession for us. You see, we don't stand before God based upon our condition. We stand before God based upon the position that he has given us. He has clothed us with the righteousness of Jesus. We could never produce that type of righteousness on our own. And having said that, we can really appreciate the glory of grace. Because in grace, we live in the favor of God. In this covenant of grace through faith, we put our faith in, not our own ability to walk perfectly before the Lord, which we know we will never. We strive as much as we can. We should hate it when we fail, but we should understand we're going to fail. We will, in the flesh. But we're more than victors as a new creation in Christ. In Christ Jesus, we are perfect. In Christ Jesus, we're without blemish. In Christ Jesus, we are justified, which means we've been examined and there is no record of sin ever found in our life. That means the book of your life is the book of the life of Jesus. In other words, you have not only been given his righteousness and your sins covered and your body of death or the sin nature, your old nature in Adam has been crucified with Christ. So therefore now, you know, it's present with us at all times, as Paul said. But Paul said, you know, this causes me to be a wretched man, but I'm not condemned. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will save me? Thanks be to God that Jesus does. So it's very hard, because what happens is some people will say, well, you're preaching that you can lax, you know, obeying God. No, we're not teaching that. That's what they accused Paul of, you know, slanderously reported, let us sin all the more so God's grace will be manifested. You know, God's grace is so great. The more we sin, you know, God's grace just covers it, shows it, brings glory to God. Well, that's not right, because the wrath of God rests upon the sons of disobedience. Hey, you're going to slip enough when you're trying to hit the mark. You know what I'm saying? God has not saved us to not try to hit the mark of pleasing him and obeying him. That's a standard that we live by. You can't find one fault in any of the Ten Commandments of God, not one. There's no fault anywhere. Where is there a fault in any of those commandments? There are none. And everybody knows in their heart that they should, you know, strive to be obedient to those. But we also know, if we're honest with ourselves, that strive as we do and we must, we will never achieve perfection there through our efforts. Therefore, our salvation is not going to be through the law, the works of the law through us, because no law, all the law can do is show us what God's standard is and show us that when we fall short of it, we're in violation of his law. We have sinned. Because sin is a transgression of the law, 1 John 3:4. And the wages of sin is death, Romans chapter 6, verse 23. So now that makes Christ as our Savior and the gospel of grace valuable. Because we see in 1 John chapter 3 that when we're born again, sin is not imputed to us, that we do not sin. It may seem like we do, and we do in the natural. He says in chapter 1, if you say you don't sin, you're a liar. So, but in chapter 3, he says, when you're born again, you don't practice sin. Sin is not imputed to us. You're trying your best. You know, that's all we ask our children. I had 5 children. Sarah that just sang, Michael that gave the sermonette, 2 of my children, Matthew that played guitar, 2 of my children. And you know, I would give them instructions. I would tell them what I expected of them, what I wanted them to do, you know, because we raised them all in the Lord from the time they were born. And for the most part, they tried. And that's all they did was try, because they made mistakes. They fell short. I would tell Michael, I said, listen, don't leave your toys outside. If I find a toy, after a while, I just said, okay, now if I find a toy you've left outside, I'm just going to take it and I'm going to put it. There was a van that we had there for a while, an older work van on the lot that needed a transmission done on. We hadn't had the transmission done, so I just put the toy, I just opened the back and put it in there. Before long, it was filled with toys. There's toys all in there. And I feel bad about it, you know. But I was trying to teach him, you know, to be responsible and to obey my instructions. So every once in a while, he's little, you know, and every once in a while, I'd let him get up there and look in there and pick out a toy to redeem. He'd redeem a toy out of there, you know. And I didn't ask him to pay for it or any, you know, in any certain way. We're going to begin over in Luke chapter 18, and this is a prophecy of that was given to Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist. I mean, not, was it not 18? Verse 1, Luke chapter 1, it is. We'll go to 18 a little bit later. And verse 67. And his father, Zacharias, that's John the Baptist's father, was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he prophesied, saying, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited us and accomplished redemption for his people, and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of David, his servant. As he spoke by the mouth of the holy prophets from of old, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us." Now understand, there is no salvation before this. Now, you've heard the scripture and read it, I'm sure, where Jesus said, "Blessed are those." He said, "You believe, for you have seen." That's what he told his disciples. But he said, "Blessed are those who have believed, yet they have not seen." And you may have heard ministers say that that was referring to us in the future. But it really wasn't, because we've seen. We are witnesses. We've seen. We're not people who have not seen. It's not talking about have seen the early miracles that Jesus did, you know, in the presence of his apostles. He's talking about those like Abraham, like righteous Abel, like Elijah, like Elisha, like Rahab, Sarah. I mean, he's talking about people who lived before Christ came. Abraham, those who lived before, they could not look, listen to me. We can look back and see the cross, amen? Amen. Can you look back and see what God has done? Can you look back and see that God provided his own son as a sacrifice for your sins and mine? Yeah, we can look back. Well, could Abraham look back and see that? No. He didn't see it, but he believed it would be. See, Abraham did not believe, he didn't see it. He couldn't look back to see that God had provided. He looked ahead and believed that God would provide. Blessed is he who has believed, yet has not seen. It's talking about the cloud of witnesses who went before us, before Christ came. Blessed is he who is not seen. So the reason I say that is they had salvation in their faith that God would provide. We have our salvation in faith knowing that God has provided. You see the difference? They had to look ahead and believe that God would provide. Now notice, verse 71, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy toward our fathers, and notice, and to remember his holy covenant. What do you mean to remember his holy covenant? Didn't he give that covenant at Sinai? He offered it at Sinai. You see that in Exodus chapter 19. But you also see that they didn't receive it. And that's why they received another one, as we see in Galatians chapter 3 and also in chapter 4, where Paul said these two covenants, allegorically speaking, are two women, Sarah and Hagar. You know, one corresponding to the present Jerusalem, and the other one to the Jerusalem above. One to slavery, one to freedom. You see, there are two covenants. So the Sinai covenant was given, but now another covenant that was promised to Abraham has been ratified by the blood of Jesus. And then Abraham becomes the father of all who are the faithful, regardless of whether they're Israelite. Because if you're born of the Spirit, you are the true Israel. That's what we see in Romans chapter 9. It's not the children of the flesh, but it is the children of the promise. That's what he said. So, verse 71, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy toward our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to Abraham, our father. See, it's Abraham's covenant, the covenant of promise, by which we are looking for a holy city. We're looking for a heavenly country. To grant us that we, being rescued from the hand of our enemies, may serve without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all of our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, and will go on before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give his people the knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of sins. You see, this is all connected with the covenant. So salvation is through the ratification of that covenant and us receiving that covenant. Now, that also means that under that covenant, God's laws are written in our minds and our hearts. So it's not a covenant without law. A covenant of grace through faith is not a covenant without obedience to the law. It is just that when you fall short to the obedience of the law, God's blood atones for you. It's not imputed to you because you were in Christ Jesus. And the transgression goes to the body of death that is present with us at all times, as we see in Romans chapter 7. However, it does not include all of the hundreds of laws that were added after Sinai. You know, the only thing that God spoke to the children of Israel at Sinai were the Ten Commandments. But then after that, after the people backed away and they said, we will not hear God's voice anymore, Moses, you be an intercessor for us. You have to understand in chapter 19, God said through Moses, he said, Moses, you tell the children of Israel to get ready to meet me in 3 days. Consecrate themselves because I will come down and I will speak to them my covenant from Sinai. Do you hear that? Speak to them my covenant from Sinai. And if they will obey my covenant, they, all of Israel, will be a whole nation of priests. Now, did that happen? No. Did all of Israel become a nation of priests? In fact, there was no Levitical priesthood at this time. There was just the high priesthood of Aaron. But after that, after they built the golden calf, then God instituted a priesthood for Israel of the tribe of Levi. You see. So they did not become a whole nation of priests. But you know what you are? When you entered into the covenant of Abraham, the covenant of grace through faith, ratified by the blood of Jesus, then you became a royal priesthood. That's what we find in 1 Peter chapter 2. You're a royal priesthood, a kingdom of priests. And that's what a holy nation, and that's what he promised them, but they did not become that. Now, let's go over to Luke chapter 18. Now, this is the story of the self-righteous Pharisee and the tax collector, and they're praying in the temple. Now, one of them knows he's a sinner, and the other one is self-righteous. The other one thinks because he knows the law and he does a few things outwardly, he doesn't understand that inwardly he is violating the standard of God. That inwardly, outwardly it looks like he's holding the standard of God. To the letter he may be holding the standard of God. Maybe he is not practicing adultery, but perhaps he has lust in his heart. You see, maybe he's not stealing from someone, yet there's greed in his heart. Yet he may be coveting in his heart. But see, under the Sinai covenant, that is not a violation of the letter of the law. Amen. So now notice here, and we'll begin in verse 9. And he also told this parable to some people who trusted in themselves. Do you hear that? They trusted in themselves. I know people. Matter of fact, I know somebody that looks back at me in the mirror every morning that used to trust in himself. I was stupid enough to think because I believed and strived and tried to keep God's commandments that I actually did. I realize now that I don't, not in the natural, but I have received a perfect life. His name is Jesus, who never sinned, who kept his Father's commandments. And he told them this parable to some people who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. They trusted that they were righteous, and they viewed others with contempt. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. And the Pharisee stood and was praying to himself, God, I thank you that I'm not like other people, swindlers, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector over here. I fast twice a week, and I pay tithes of all I get. But the tax collector, standing some distance away, he wouldn't even come near. He didn't feel worthy. Was even unwilling to lift up his eyes to heaven, but was beating his chest, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus said, I tell you, that man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Now, God credits righteousness apart from works. And thank God for that, because our works are feeble indeed, and our works are incomplete indeed. So he credits righteousness to us apart from works. And the righteous under grace, notice, are those who know they are sinners. This man knew he was a sinner. And they know they're hopeless. They know they're in need of having their sins not only forgiven once, but continually forgiven every day. That's why Jesus said, let this be how you pray. And he said, our Father who is in heaven. And he goes on to say, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. That's a daily prayer. Now let's go over to Romans chapter 4. And we'll see this truth very clearly, that God credits righteousness to us apart from work. That doesn't mean we don't have works. We understand fully that we do, but our works are not good enough. You see what I mean? Our works are not good enough. Now, I had my children try to help me do things sometimes, and sometimes their works weren't good enough. Sometimes, well, yeah, you tried to rake the yard, or you tried to mow the yard, or you tried to do something, but you tried to help Mom bake a cake, but, you know, it looks like Ellie Mae's biscuits here, you know. You could knock somebody out with it if you threw it. That's a hard cupcake. I mean, but the effort is there. Amen. You remember that, don't you? Okay. Romans chapter 4. Notice verse 2. For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the Scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. What did he believe? He believed that God would provide a Savior for him. That's what he believed. He believed that God would provide. I mean, first of all, it was pictured in the sacrifice to Isaac. He believed that if he gave Isaac, then God would give him back. He didn't know how. He said maybe God would raise him from the dead. We don't, you know, he wondered how, but he believed. So he put his trust in God. For what does the Scripture say, verse 3? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now, if you believe that God gave his only son, Jesus, for your righteousness, and you submit to him, and you yield to him, and you seek to please him and obey him as best as you can, then you receive the righteousness, you know, of Jesus Christ. And we find, actually, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, where not only did he become our curse, but he made us the blessing of God. And that he took our sins in order that we might become the righteousness of God, that we may receive his righteousness. Now, do you really want to practice your own righteousness, or do you want to have the perfect righteousness of Jesus? So that means we cannot acquire that through anything we can do except the fact that we can believe and receive from God the Father, what he provided in his Son. But to the one who does not work but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is credited as righteousness. So if you believe in God that he justifies the ungodly, in other words, you don't justify yourself, but he justifies you. Just as David also speaks of the blessing on the man whom God credits righteousness apart from works, he wrote, "Blessed are those whose lawless deeds have been forgiven and whose sins have been covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will not take into account." So not only does he wash away our sins, but he doesn't take our sins into account. When we're in the... Now listen, Paul acknowledged that he had sins, but he also acknowledged that he was above those sins in Christ Jesus. Amen. And that brings glory to God, not glory to ourselves. We don't think about what we have been able to do, but we glory in what God has done through Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And we strive to obey him. We strive to obey him. And the more we strive to obey him, the more we understand the value of a perfect, righteous life that was lived and was given for us. Amen? Now let's turn over to James chapter 2. We'll see here that works cannot produce salvation, but that salvation produces works. Amen? Works cannot produce salvation, but salvation does produce works. So if someone is saved and they don't have any works, they're not striving to obey God, well, then you have to question whether they're even saved or not. They should question it for sure. Here in chapter 2, verse 14, it says, "What use is it, my brethren, if someone says he has faith, but he has no works? Can that faith save him?" Now notice, "What use is it, my brethren, if someone says he has faith, but he has no works? Can that faith save him?" In other words, faith has to be alive, and to be alive, it has to be working. In Romans chapter 1, Paul said that he was bringing about to the Gentiles the obedience of faith. So it's not just the belief that faith brings, but the obedience of faith. The faith produces obedience or works, obedient works. "If a brother or sister is without clothing and in need of daily food, and one of you says to him, 'Go in peace, be warmed and be filled,' and yet you do not give them what is necessary for their body, what use is that?" In other words, if you don't do anything, what use is that? "Even so, faith, if it has no works, is dead, being by itself. But someone may well say, 'Well, you have faith, I have works. Show me your faith without the works, and I will show you my faith by my works.'" In other words, works is a demonstration of faith. "And I will show you my faith by my works. If you believe that God is one, well, you do well, but the demons also believe, and they shudder. But are you willing to recognize, you foolish fellow?" So James is saying it's a foolish thing to think that you can have faith and have no works. "But if you're willing to recognize, but are you willing to recognize, you foolish fellow, that faith without works is useless? Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up Isaac, his son, on the altar? You see, that faith was working with his works, and as a result of the works, faith was perfected." It was complete. So we would have an incomplete faith if our lives are not demonstrating obedience. "And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, 'And Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. And he was called the friend of God.'" You see that a man is justified by works and not by faith alone. "In the same way, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For just as a body without the spirit is dead, so also faith without works is dead." So, see, there's a ditch on either side, brother. There's a ditch on either side. You can look at yourself and say, "Look at me. I'm like that Pharisee. I do everything. I know. I study God's commandments, and I'm striving to do what he says, and I put confidence in myself, and therefore you're really self-righteous." Or you can go Another way, as Paul said, is slanderedly reported of him, and he said in Romans that, you know, let us just sin all the more because grace, God's grace just makes God's grace bigger, just magnifies God's grace, gives more glory to God. Well, that's silly, you know. So the answer is what? The answer is we strive to hit the mark. The answer is we try to our best to obey God. Is the Ten Commandments, listen, is the Ten Commandments the ministry of condemnation?
Yes.
Of course it is. Why is that? Because they're bad? Because within themselves they bring forth death? Of course. Now, they don't bring death to the holy angels in heaven. They don't bring death to God himself, do they? But they bring death when what happens? When someone violates, when someone falls short of the glory of God. It says that even the ministry of condemnation, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, came with glory. So how much more glory, this new covenant? You know, the gospel of grace, the covenant of grace, is even more with glory, but both have glory. But one of them ends in condemnation. In other words, the more you try to obey God's commandments, the more you see that you fall short, which doesn't mean that we say, well, get rid of them so I don't feel bad. That doesn't mean that. It just lets us know why we need a Savior. Amen. Why Jesus had to come and live a perfect life and give his life to us so we receive his righteousness. But would Jesus had been righteous if he had not obeyed his Father's commandments? Of course not. Would he? He wouldn't have. He wanted to please his Father. He said, not my will, but your will be done. And that's what we say. Not my will, but your will be done. So he says, just as a body without the Spirit is dead, so also faith without works is dead. Now let's go over to Ephesians chapter 2. We are saved to good works. You know how Jesus said, you know, when you do a charitable act, you give alms, you give charity, you do a charitable act. Don't let your right hand know what your left hand is doing, or left hand know what your right hand is doing. In other words, he understands that you can be thinking about, you know, you can start puffing out your chest and kind of walking like straight, you know, adjusting your clothes or your robe, you know, thinking, look what I've done. Like the self-righteous Pharisee, look at them, I'm glad I'm not a sinner like that guy over there. You know, I'm thinking about what all I do. See, when we think about what all we do, that's the trap. Another death trap is when you don't do. When you focus on what all you do and glory in it, it takes away from the glory of God. Everything is made for the glory of God, so we give glory to God. So we do things, we obey God, but we don't think about it in terms of bringing glory to ourselves. We don't think about that. Because we also know that in doing it, we are always incomplete. We're always falling short, you see. And so what that is designed to do is to magnify Jesus. The Ten Commandments are God's standard, and it's there to show us what sin is. And it should show us and be a constant reminder as we try to obey them, you know, of how weak we are in the flesh and how much we need, you know, the life of Christ in us. Amen? Because the truth of the matter is, who we are in Christ is perfect. And Paul knew that. He said it. That's how we know. He wrote it. But he also said of himself, oh, wretched man that I am. He also said, told Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 1, he said, you know, he's speaking of sinners, and he said, of them, I am chief of all. You know, and he said twice, I think, Ephesians and, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and then in the book of Ephesians, he said, I'm the least of all apostles. On the other hand, he said, you know, that there lays up for me a crown of glory, which the Lord will give me on that day. He said, you know, we're unblemished. We're without sin. We're justified in the eyes of the Lord. We are perfect in his sight. So he made a distinction of who he saw he was in the flesh and who he saw he was in the Spirit in Christ Jesus, you see. And that's what we all have to do. Therefore, we don't boast. We should never boast. Well, I keep the commandments. I keep the Sabbath, and I keep, you know, the holy days. No, we don't boast in any of that. We're just little children trying to follow our Father. We're trying to follow an example, and we're stumbling all over the place, running into stuff, and, you know, getting up, trying to dust ourselves off all the time. That's the truth, and that's how God sees us, and that's okay. Because I've seen my children like that. And it's endearing to me. I don't expect them to be able to do everything I could do. When they were little, I didn't expect them to be able to do everything I could do. It wore my heart when they tried. I was happy when they were trying. When they were trying to emulate me. When they were trying to be like me. When the children were trying to be like their mom. They were looking and they were trying to pattern themselves after their mom, trying to be after their mom. That was enough. Oh, that was enough. Because we knew their heart was right. But we also knew that they had limited abilities. They were limited in what they could do. But they weren't limited in what they wanted to do. And that's why we are little children. We're little children to God, and we have to, you know, see it that way. Now, we're going to read the scripture that about us being saved by grace, but we're going to look at it also in context in Ephesians chapter 2. Notice verse 8. For by grace you have been saved, and grace is the unmerited pardon, favor of God, the unmerited favor of God. We don't deserve His favor, but He gives His favor anyway. We live, when you live in grace, you live in God's favor. For by grace you have been saved through faith. That's faith in the grace provided in the sacrifice and life of Jesus. And you were not, and not of yourselves. In other words, we're not looking at ourselves. It is a gift of God. We don't produce it. Not as a result of works, so that no one may boast, like that self-righteous Pharisee that boasted in what he did. And he was completely blind to everything he didn't do. We have to really be honest with ourselves. God looks at the intent of our heart. We know we don't always put God first, and we feel bad about it. We should. We should feel, oh, wretched person that I am. For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, so that we should walk in them. So we're saved by grace in order to walk in works prepared beforehand. What are those works? It's the ways of God, the commandments of God, obedience to God. Then let's read it in context. We'll begin in verse 1 and read what he says leading up to this statement, so we'll understand the statement a little bit better. And you, he says, brethren, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. That's where we once were. In which you formerly walked. That's the way we used to walk. In other words, we practiced that way of life. We didn't even strive to hit any other mark. That's what we strove to do. We just walked naturally in the world according to our own corrupt, worldly nature. In which you formerly walked according to the course of this world. According to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit, notice, that is now working in who? The sons of disobedience. When people say, well, if I obey God, that's legalism. Well, that's silly. Legalism is thinking that you could actually qualify by you obeying God or keeping it. I mean, if you're that, I mean, yeah, that's legalism if you think that. But what is it if you don't even try to hit the mark? Isn't that called disobedience? On purpose? Isn't that practicing disobedience? So he says, you were once dead in your trespasses and sin, and in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world. You just followed the world. According to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit, which is the devil, which is now working in who? The sons of disobedience. The spirit of the devil is working in the sons of disobedience. It reminds me of what John said in 1 John chapter 3. He said, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. The children of the devil do not practice sin. They do not practice righteousness. And the children of God practice righteousness. Now, in chapter 1, he says, if you say you don't have sin, you're a liar. So he's not saying that you're perfect. He's saying you're trying to hit the mark. Yeah, you fall short, but you're trying. You're trying to practice. You're trying to walk after your Father. Yeah, you fall all over the place. Your little legs are short. Your feet are little. You're not quite as balanced. Among them we too formerly lived in the lust of our flesh. In other words, that's the way we used to live. We indulged the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. Why children of wrath? Because the wrath of God rests upon the children of disobedience. But God, being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even while we were dead in our transgressions, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. So he's saying, this is the way we used to walk. Well, are they practicing legalism if now they're trying to follow the Holy Spirit and try to be obedient to God? Of course they're not. Only if you're thinking that you're like the self-righteous person, that you think that, you know, you're capable of it on your own. And he has raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. So he's saying, this is how you used to walk, just whatever the world did. You didn't obey God. It says you were sons of disobedience. You disobeyed God. So he says, that's the way we used to be. But now, for by grace you've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. You didn't produce it. There is no law that can take away sins. And sin causes death and separation from God. There is no law that can do that. It takes a righteous sacrifice, the shedding of blood. Book of Hebrews says, without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness for sin. So, for by grace you've been saved, verse 8, through faith. So we just receive it by faith, you see. And that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not as a result of work, so as that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship. In other words, we're his workmanship. Do you understand? You're not your own workmanship. We're his workmanship. You and I in Christ are a work of God. You're his workmanship. In other words, he created you. You're his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Now, when you make something, you create it in order to fulfill a purpose. If you happen to decide you want to make a water pitcher, like we saw those in Africa, you know, where they would make and cure. It was made for a purpose. To hold water. Amen? So that workmanship was made to do a work. And we are made to do a work. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. In other words, we're not saved by works, we're created to works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So that shows us it's something that we practice. Amen. Now let's go over to Romans chapter 7. A changed heart hates what he once loved, and he loves what he once hated. That's what a changed heart is. Here in Romans chapter 7. Or do you not know, brethren, for I am speaking to those who know the law. And again, when we say the law here, you have to understand we're talking about the difference in two covenants. We're talking about a covenant where righteousness is by your ability to keep the law. We found that in Deuteronomy chapter 29 or 30. And a law, a covenant of grace by which we are not saved by law, but we're saved by the act of what Jesus did in giving his life for us, washing away our sins, and by his perfect life. Now, for I'm speaking, so, or do you not know, verse 1, brethren, for I'm speaking to those who know the law, that the law has jurisdiction over a person as long as he lives. Of course we know that. They don't dig up people and put them on trial, right? I mean, if they're dead, they're dead. They say, well, that guy got, I mean, he got away with it. Can't put him on trial now. He's a dead guy. You know, we don't go dig him up, all right? And we're dead. Amen. We were crucified with Christ. We found that in the previous chapter. We're not reading today. But he's building upon what he's already said, that we were crucified with Christ, therefore we died. Our old self died with him. And that's why sin has no jurisdiction over us. Sin, I mean, the law out here, the law of Russellville, the law of Arkansas, the law of the United States of America has no jurisdiction over anyone in Oakland Cemetery down here. None. Can't dig anybody up and say, all right, now we're going to put you in jail. We'll put you on trial. I mean, they'll just sit there as a stiff. For the married woman is bound to, by, so he gives an example. And this is typical Pauline, you know, the way he works. For the married woman, he's giving us up. So like the married woman is bound to by law to her husband while he is living, but her husband, but if her husband died, she is released from the law according to release from the law concerning the husband. So he's saying, see, if, you know, yeah, two people, if they're married, they're bound to one another. One of them dies, they're no longer bound to one another anymore. I mean, you know, nobody, you know, sets a dead person at the dinner table and says, let me cook you breakfast. I mean, they bury them, and they're not bound to them anymore. So then, if while her husband is living, she is joined to another man, she shall be called an adulteress. But if her husband dies, she is free from the law, that she is not an adulteress, though she is joined to another man. Now, see, he's given that as an example. Therefore, my brethren, you also were made to die to the law. Why did we die? Why did we have to die in Christ? Because we sinned. What is sin? The transgression of the law, 1 John chapter 3, 4. And what do we find the wages of sin is? Death. Romans chapter 6, verse 23. The wages of sin of death. So we had to die. We had to die in order to be joined to someone else. We were joined to Adam. We had to be joined to the second Adam, the life-giving spirit. So he says, therefore, brethren, you also were made to die, verse 4, to the law through the body of Christ, so that you might be joined to another, to him who was raised from the dead, in order that we might bear fruit for him. So we went with him into the grave. The body of death died, who we are in Adam, and we were risen as a new creation in Christ with him. For while we were in the flesh, the sinful passions which were aroused by the law were at work in the members of our body to bear fruit for death. But now we have been released from the law, having died to that which we were bound, so that we serve in newness of the Spirit and not in oldness of the letter. Now, what do we find newness of the Spirit is? Does that mean it does it away? No, it doesn't, because we find was the letter say, don't commit adultery? The Spirit says, don't have lust in your heart if you commit adultery already. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? Well, may it never be. On the contrary, I would not have come to know sin except through the law, for I would not have known about coveting, and that's a fact. No one would know about coveting. No one said, what do you mean? I didn't do anything wrong. Well, you thought about it. So what? I mean, I didn't do anything. How does that hurt anybody? It hurt you. It's against God's nature. It's selfish. What we find in Philippians chapter 2, where Paul said, let this attitude be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who although he existed with God, is equal to God from all the beginning, he emptied himself of divinity in the likeness of man in order to bring many sons to glory. You know, he didn't think it's something to be selfishly hung on to, but he emptied it in order to bring us along. He says, for I would have not known about coveting if the law had not said, you shall not covet. In other words, he would not have known it was wrong. He wouldn't even thought about it. But sin, taking opportunity through the commandment, produced in me coveting of every kind. For apart from the law, sin is dead. Now, let me ask you. That sounded awkward as we read it. But are we to say that the law actually caused him to covet?
No.
It revealed that he was coveting.
Amen.
Because as we see in James, you know, when we look at God's law, we're looking in a mirror. And we see ourselves as God sees us. We see all the dirt on us, if we're honest. And that's what he's saying. He said, man, once I knew that, once I understood that, then I saw that I coveted all over the place. So he says, verse 9, I was once alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin became alive and I died. And this commandment, which was to result in life, proved to result in death for me. For sin, taking an opportunity through the commandment, deceived me and through it killed me. So then the law is holy, and the commandment is holy and righteous and good. Now, see, the law doesn't, it's not a, like the Ten Commandments, it's a ministry of condemnation to us. It's not a ministry of condemnation to those who keep it. It wasn't a ministry of condemnation to Jesus personally because Jesus kept it. And since Jesus kept it, he didn't die for his own sins. He could die for our sins, for those who did not obey God. Amen. Verse 13, therefore did that which was good become a cause of death for me? Well, may it never be. Rather, it was sin. In other words, it identified as sin. That it might be sin by affecting. Ooh, am I cutting out here? Through that which is good, so that through the commandment sin will become utterly sinful, or to be shown to be sin. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of flesh. I'm sold into bondage to sin. For what I am doing, I do not understand. For I'm not practicing what I would like to do, but I'm doing the very thing I hate. That's what Paul's saying. Now, I can identify with that. But if I do the very thing I do not want to do, I agree with the law, because I'll confess that the law is good. So now, no longer am I the one doing it, but sin dwells in me. In other words, if I find that I'm doing the very thing I hate, it's not really me. It's sin that's present with me. If I say something and immediately I hate what I just said because I know it's wrong, it's insensitive, it's hurtful, you know, it's hateful, and I immediately hate that, you know, you say, oh, wretched man that I am in the flesh, but you understand also that you hate it, and it's not you. You have to take responsibility for it here and now. But God, he washes it away by his own blood. Verse 16, but I do the very thing I do not want to do. I agree with the law. I confess that the law is good. So now no longer am I the one doing it, but it's sin that dwells in me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh. Let's separate the flesh from the spirit now. For the willing is present in me, but the doing of the good is not. And that's important. Is the willing present within you? Do you want to obey God? Do you want to serve him? Do you want to do all you can to be faithful to him? For the good that I want to do, I do not do, but I practice the very evil that I do not want. But if I'm doing the very thing I do not want, I'm no longer the one doing it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then the principle that evil is present in me, the one who wants to do good. For I joyfully concur with the law of God in the inner man, but I see a different law in the members of my body. And that law wages war against the law of my mind, making me a prisoner of the law of sin, which is in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will set me free from the body of this death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, on one hand, I myself with my mind, I am serving the law of God. But on the other hand, with my flesh, the law of sin. Verse 1, chapter 8. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. So it's a law that sets us free that God created. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And as an offering for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. Now, what he's saying is that knowledge of what God's standard is not enough. Knowledge is not enough. You can know what God wants you to do. It doesn't mean you're going to do it, because you're going to do the very thing that you shouldn't do from time to time. Paul did it. He hated it. He hated it. He hated it, but he realized that that was a part of living in this life, and that's a part of living in this life for us too. So we don't take sin lightly? No. And also, we don't allow, you know, the devil to engender a spirit of condemnation in us when we fall. You know, because he'll do that. He'll say, look at you. Look at what you just did. You know, you're not obeying God. Look what you did. Look at that. Look what you did. Don't you know that's sin? You dishonor God. Don't think he's going to forgive you for that. You know better than that. You did it anyway. You held on to unforgiveness. You had lust in your heart. You know, you spoke a sharp word and then did it again. He'll accuse you. He is the accuser of the brethren. He'll continue to accuse you night and day. The Holy Spirit will convict you. The Holy Spirit will convict you to say, oh, wretched person that I am, chief sinner of all. The Holy Spirit will also let you know who you are in Christ Jesus. The Holy Spirit will also not cause you to feel hopeless, but to put your hope in him. Realizing that you could never put your hope in yourself or your own abilities. And that's the key to it all. Verse 3 again. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh as an offering for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh so that the requirement of the law may be fulfilled in us. So the requirement of the law is, you know, to had to be obeyed. And it is fulfilled, you know, that what he did fulfilled the requirement of the law in us. So though we fall short, though we break his commandments, though we don't always love him with all of our heart, though we lie, though we have unforgiveness, maybe even hatred in our heart from time to time, what Jesus did when he offered once and for all, he condemned sin in the flesh. So our flesh is condemned, but who we are in the spirit is eternal. So that the requirement of the law may be filled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now, let's just go over to Hebrews chapter 8. We'll close Hebrews chapter 8. Speaking of the new covenant, the covenant of grace ratified by the blood of the Lamb of God. But now he, that is Jesus, as our high priest, has obtained a more excellent ministry, by as much as he is also the mediator of a better covenant. So it's a better covenant, which has been enacted upon better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no occasion sought for the second. This covenant is not about a land flowing with milk and honey across the Jordan. This is about a city whose architect and builder is God, a heavenly country. For finding fault with them, he says, behold, days are coming, says the Lord, when I will effect a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not like the covenant which I made with their fathers. So it's not the same covenant, and it's not like it. On the day I took them by the hand to lead them out of the hand of Egypt, for they did not continue in my covenant, and I did not care for them, says the Lord. For this is a covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. And the reason he's saying house of Israel here is because he's writing this letter to the Hebrews. So he's emphasizing to them, I will put my laws into their minds, and I will write them on their heart. So it's not a lawless covenant. And I will be their God, my Father, and they shall not teach everyone his fellow citizen and everyone his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all will know me from the least to the greatest of them. For I will be merciful to their iniquities. It doesn't say that we won't have iniquities. It says he'll be merciful to our iniquities. Goes with what John said in 1 John chapter 1. If you say you don't have sin, you're a liar. But if you confess your sins, he's faithful to forgive them. For I will be merciful to their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more. I like that. I like that covenant, that he will remember our sins no more. Now, that's talking about past, present, and future, as long as we're striving to hit the mark. And he set a new covenant. When he set a new covenant, he has made the first covenant, made the first obsolete. But whatever's becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to disappear. And we'll conclude in chapter 10, notice verse 26. But we have to understand that if we go on sinning willfully, after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins. In other words, we are leaving the gospel ratified by Jesus. We're leaving the covenant, gospel of the covenant. So if we go on sinning on purpose, willfully, in other words, we don't even try to obey God. We don't even try to keep his commandments. There no longer remains a sacrifice for sins. That's to say that as long as we are in Christ and we're striving to obey him, there is a sacrifice for sins. But what remains is a terrifying expectation of judgment and the fury of a fire which will consume the adversaries. Now notice verse 28. This is important. Anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much severe punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and is regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has insulted the Spirit of grace? Now, notice what the writer of Hebrews is saying here is, you Hebrews, you know what the law of Moses says. That if two or more witnesses come to get forward and say that this person is guilty of something that is punishable by death, that person dies on the basis of those two witnesses. Now he's saying that's how it is in the Sinai covenant, in the law of Moses, under that covenant. So how much severer punishment? So he's saying, listen, that's the Sinai covenant. Now the covenant of grace through faith, how much severe the punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled underfoot the Son of God? You see, because that covenant was ratified by animals' blood. So he says, how much severe punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and has regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant? This is a covenant that was ratified by the Son of God, by which he was sanctified, set apart, and made holy, and has insulted the Spirit of grace, you see. So you can't turn back, can't go on sinning willfully in this covenant of grace because you trample the blood of the sacrifice of Jesus, and we insult the Spirit of grace. What is the Spirit of grace? The Spirit of grace is a... if you have the proper Spirit of grace, it is there that we're saved not to continue in sin, but we're saved to draw near to God. Earlier it says, let us enter through the veil. You know, earlier in the same chapter. So this is a continuation of what he says there. It is there in order that we may enter in boldly through the veil into the very presence of God. But if we go on sinning willfully, we're not going to enter in. We're trampling the blood of Jesus, and we're insulting the Spirit of grace. The very reason grace is extended to us is in order to draw us near to God. For we know him who says, vengeance is mine, I will repay, and again the Lord will judge his people. Verse 35, therefore do not throw away your confidence, which has great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised. For yet in a very little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. So we can shrink back. We don't want to shrink back. But we are not of those who shrink back to destruction. That's what happens when someone shrinks back. But we're of those who have faith to the preserving of the soul. Amen. Hallelujah. Brian, would you close us in prayer?